Welcome everybody. So today I'm glad to introduce you IEEE EMC Society Distinguished Lecturer, Professor Andy Marvin. So Andy Marvin received his PhD degree from University of Sheffield in 1978, exactly when I was born actually. So he is currently Professor of Applied Electromagnetics in the Department of Electronic Engineering in University of York. His main research interests are EMC measurement and modeling techniques, EMC antennas and electromagnetic shielding, measurement and modeling. To date, starting in 1976, he is an author of over 300 papers. In 1992, he and Dr. Stuart Potter invented the Bylog EMC measurement antenna. He is a fellow of the Royal Academy of Engineering and IEEE fellow. Thank you for coming.
Thank you, and thank you for inviting me. Okay, only two corrections so far then to the introduction. One is, I am no longer employed by the University of York, so I'm no longer Professor of Applied Electromagnetism. I'm now Professor Emeritus in the department, so that means I live on a pension rather than having a salary. So, sorry about the out-of-date thing there. And I'm also very old, and that means that I'm now a Life Fellow of the IEEE. And to become a Life Fellow of the IEEE, you have to add together your chronological age with the number of years that you've been a member of the IEEE, and when that gets to 100, you become a Life Member and you don't have to pay anymore. So I guess it's possible to become a Life Member when you're 50 if you join when you're born, but I don't think they actually allow that, so you have to be a little bit older than that anyway, even though I look much younger. So hopefully you can understand my English.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, that's good. And am I speaking loud enough? I know there's a little bit of amplification here. Is that okay? Good. And I'm going to be speaking for about an hour, but this is the first time as a DL, Distinguished Lecturer, that I've given this actual lecture. So, as usual, I'm not quite sure how long it will last, but it'll be about an hour. It's time for about that. What I'm going to be talking about is electromagnetic shielding. That was one of the research interests that I have, that Oscar said in the introduction. And on Friday, I'm giving a second lecture at a neighbouring university, which is more about my research into shielding. So this lecture is sort of introductory shielding, electromagnetic shielding, and it's aimed, I hope you don't mind, at undergraduate level. I understand there might be some undergraduate students here, so this is aimed at an undergraduate level. I'll be giving a more postgraduate level lecture on Friday at the neighbouring university, if anybody's interested. Now, that will be about how to level work I've done on measuring shielding and different ways of doing it. But this is introductory to shielding. Now, I have a small grandson, just over 2 years old, and when you give him a present, it's the usual thing with a small child. He likes the box. And that's the big pleasure, is the box. And what's inside it is almost irrelevant, because he likes to play with the box first. And that's me. I'm not really desperately interested in electronics, to be absolutely frank. I've worked in electronics all my life. I don't find it very interesting. But I do find the box interesting. The shield is much more interesting. And so I come from I come from an engineering background, I'm sort of becoming, in my old age, more and more of a physicist. And more interested in the sort of the physics of what's going on, rather than thinking about the sort of the electronics. So I'm going to be talking about the box in which we put our equipment, rather than the equipment itself. And that's shielding. So basically, our electromagnetic shield is a barrier. It's a barrier that we use to reduce the amount of electromagnetic energy either gets into an electronic system from outside or gets out of the electronic system and goes elsewhere, possibly causing interference. And the only reason that we have a shield is because we need to protect our equipment from external interference. This is the electromagnetic compatibility problem. We need that external interference protection. And we might also need to protect other equipment from what our piece of equipment does when it's working. Those of you who study antennas will be aware that if you want to make an antenna work, you take some sort of electrical conductor, you impress an electrical current on it, if you will, and if that electrical current is time varying, then that electrical conductor will radiate. That's on 10. Well, of course, the almost any electronic circuit fits that description. So once you've got time-varying currents in your electronic circuits, the electronic circuit will, in its own right, behave as an antenna, and it will radiate electromagnetic waves. And so we have to try and control that. While we can design electronic equipment to try and minimise this, we can minimise rise times in our digital circuits, we can reduce frequencies down to the absolute minimum, we can make clever printed circuit board design that, that minimises the radiation. In the end, the last thing that we have is to put a barrier around the circuit and stop it from radiating in that sense. And of course, antennas tend to be reciprocal devices. If they will transmit, they will receive. And so electronic circuits also act as receiving antennas. And so they are susceptible to electromagnetic interference from outside. And that might be from radio transmitters that are intentional, a real radio transmitter that's meant to transmit, or it might be from some other piece of electronic equipment that is an unintentional transmitter. And again, we can do things to minimise the susceptibility of our electronic circuits to external interference. But again, our last resort is to put a physical barrier around the circuit, and that is our shield. And that's the, if you like, is what I want to be talking about. So as it says there in the second bullet point, the shield is in the form of an enclosure, a physical barrier around our electronic system. Now what makes the shield work? Well, the shield is made from a material that has the right sort of properties, and in general that simply means an electrical conductor. And the best material we can have for the most part is some sort of metallic conductor. We might make it metallic film on plastic, we might fill a resin matrix with conducting particles or whatever, but in the end we want an electrical conductor to make our shield. And so we can look at the performance of the materials which we make the shield and assess how good they're going to be. Basically, the better conductor you've got, the better shield you've got. In some circumstances, you can make a perfectly adequate shield from wet newspaper. That will work. Well, but that will work under some circumstances. But then when you've got your shielding material, then it's the what I've called the imperfections of the enclosure that really determines how well the shield is going to work. So I'll be talking a lot about that as well, because we can think in terms of how well the shielding material works, and as I've said, most shielding materials work very, very well indeed. If you've got a thin sheet of metal, aluminium or copper or whatever, steel, maybe a tenth of a millimetre thick, that will in most circumstances give you all the shielding performance you'll ever need for any circumstance. But when you try and make that material into an enclosure, well, you have to have a join, and then you have to have an aperture to put something in, and then cables have to go in, and then there's something for a display. It's all those things that limit the amount of shielding that you get. It's not the material itself. So two aspects there. One is the material, easy. The second one is the actual structure of the shield itself, difficult. So those are the things that I want to talk about. Now, we talk about shielding effectiveness of enclosures, and shielding effectiveness is defined in this slide here. We've got our enclosure, which in this diagram, which I from somewhere else, basically. It's called a box. That's an enclosure. Like I said, the box in which the present comes here. And we've got an electromagnetic wave impinging on the shield coming up here. And if you take the box away, then we've got an electric field there, which is the field strength of the electromagnetic wave. And then if we put the box, then inside the box, we've got, hopefully, but not necessarily, a reduced field strength. And that's the shielding effect of the enclosure. The effect of the enclosure is to reduce the internal field strength. That's what we're trying to do. We're trying to protect what's inside there from what's outside. So we've got this wave coming along. I've characterized it in terms of its field strength. We could use power density also if you wish. We could use magnetic field strength. They're all related. But typically we use electric field strength. and we want to minimise it to protect our ego. And that's looking at the shield from what we would call an immunity perspective, looking at how we can improve the immunity of our government to our external interference. And if we take the empty box, then internal field, external field. If we look at the ratio of the external field to the internal field, that hopefully is a number much bigger than one, because the external field should be bigger. And then we can express that as in decibels here. It's a field quantity, so it's 20 log 10 decibels. And we can talk about shielding effectiveness of the enclosure. And that tells us how well it's working. Typically, at high frequencies, and we'll come to talk about what we mean by that a little bit later on, we could talk about magnetic field or electric field shielding, and they'll come out to be the same number. At low frequencies, they come out to be different, rather different. Conventionally, though, shielding effectiveness is determined in terms of the electric field. Now, what's missing from this, from my perspective and from my research interest, just if I can make a little sort of commercial break for my lecture on Friday, is that what happens inside the box when you put something inside it? Shielding effectiveness here is defined for an empty box. Is it different if we put something inside it? And the answer is yes, it's spectacularly different, or can be. So I've been trying for some time through the standards bodies to have an improvement on this definition. Without success, it has to be said, because it takes a long time to move a standards body. As I speak today, shielding is still defined for an empty enclosure, even though it doesn't actually help you very much. Presumably, one with a better shielding effectiveness will give you more protection than one with a poorer shielding effectiveness. What it doesn't enable you to do is to sort of actually easily quantify the effectiveness. So that's a problem with it. That's a problem we've been trying to address in our research. But just sticking with the basic definition, that's where we are at the moment. So, a few more thoughts about it. It's a simplification. I've defined it as a single number, field inside the box relative to the field outside the box. But the field inside the box will change quite a lot over the interior space. So where do we define it? If I just go back to the picture there, I've drawn a vertical electric field there. If you think of the boundary conditions that exist for electric fields with a metallic boundary, let's imagine this box is made out of metal, then at this point here, tangential to the surface, the electric field must be zero. That's the boundary condition. So there must be some variability of the electric field as we go through the box, and yet we've got a single number definition. So it is a simplification. That problem as well. That's something we can address later. So the amplitude varies within the box. Electric magnetic fields are vectors. They have direction. Again, a good diagram. There's nothing to say that the internal electric field in that box has to be the same direction as the external field. It could be in a different direction, depending on how it's got in. So again, that's not reflected in the definition. That's a problem. And then lastly, the enclosure context modifying internal fields. So again, we've got a potential issue there with what's going on. We then have the principle of reciprocity, and of course in electromagnetism we love reciprocity. If you study antennas, I used to teach antennas to our undergraduate students, and so I'd start with showing them how a transmitting antenna worked, and then when we came to receiving antennas, I'd say, principle of reciprocity, they work in exactly the same way backwards, more or less, something like that, simplistically. But the principle of reciprocity, as it said in very big red writing there, has to be applied correctly. And it's a very specific principle. If you look at the principle of reciprocity in a good electromagnetics textbook, it is very specific in the way in which it is defined. And it is very easy to sort of say, oh, the shield is reciprocal. And you can get completely the wrong idea, the wrong answer. You have to apply the principle of reciprocity very carefully, absolutely correctly. And then the shield is reciprocal. But look at the principle of reciprocity before you apply it, very carefully. So, every time I click on, I put this thing down in a different place and then I can't find it anymore. I have a little bit more discipline in what I'm doing. Put it there. Okay, so let's think about the shield again from the, what I'm calling the unity perspective, external interference. How does the energy get in? Well, several ways in which the energy can penetrate. All fairly obvious, really. Here's a shield around a, well, it's a motherboard, if you like. Some components on it. I mentioned the performance of the material as a shield, how well it stops electromagnetic energy getting in. And we have to accept that energy may get in through the material itself. Usually that's the least important aspect, as I've said, but may be a case where energy can actually just diffuse through the, or pass through the material. There are apertures in the shield, ventilation holes, displays, places where you put your USB stick, all these things are apertures in your shield. So energy will get in through the apertures, and you can think about the apertures. And also cables. We take cables into our enclosures. And what we do with our cables when we take them into the enclosure, that's absolutely critical. You can make yourself an incredibly good shielding enclosure and wreck the entire shielding performance of it by not taking the cable in correctly. If you simply take a cable in through a hole in a shield, as I've shown there, then you better not bother with the box. Just take it away. Because the cable will act as an antenna. Currents will be induced onto the cable in the usual sort of way, and they will propagate all the way along there and couple up into the internal part of the box. So your shielding is totally compromised if you don't connect the cables properly. And shielded cables, cables connected to filters and so on, again, the installation, mechanical installation, is as important as anything in ensuring good shielding. So those are the ways in which we can get energy in. So we've got diffusion through walls, apertures, and cables. Diffusion through walls is really a low frequency phenomenon. And again, we'll look at that, what we mean by that. By low frequency, so we're mainly talking about, say, 50 hertz or audio frequencies, those kind of frequencies. Once we get up to radio frequencies, up into the megahertz and gigahertz range, then what gets through the enclosure walls is negligible, usually, if we've made out any reasonable temperature shielding, and then it becomes apertures and cables that are the significant determinators, or determinants in how the shield is going to work. So we're going to start with low frequencies and work our way up. Okay, now I'm guessing you've probably, if you've done any electromagnetism at all, you'll know the skin effect. Now that's where if you've got an electrical conductor and you press somehow an oscillating current onto it, then the oscillating current tends to confine itself to the surface layer of the conductor. It doesn't penetrate all the way through. And the skin effect is critical in the way in which we look at the way in which shielding materials work. Electromagnetic energy doesn't penetrate well into good conductors, it's attenuated very heavily. This is the skin effect. And the skin depth, which we call delta, is defined by the depth at which the wave amplitude is reduced by a factor of 1 over E, about 8.7 dBs. And so you get an exponential decay of wave amplitude going into the material. The wave amplitude in a good conductor expresses itself mostly through conduction current in the material. So this is the current flowing in the conductor material. It's in the surface layer with a sort of exponential decay as you go into the material. So 1 over E, 8.7 dBs, about 8.6, yeah, 8.7. That skin depth, it decreases with increasing frequency. So as we increase the frequency, the skin depth gets smaller, gets closer to the surface. We increase the electrical conductivity, we make a better conductor, the skin depth gets smaller. And if we increase the magnetic permeability, then again, through the relative permeability, the skin depth gets smaller. There's a sort of equation there you can see at the bottom of the screen. Not really written in the equation text, but we've got notice to them the minus a half there, so it's the reciprocal of that, that product of frequency, conductivity, and permeability. And you think, okay, well, what does that mean? Well, typically it means that we're looking at skin depths in the range of micrometers once we're up in megahertz frequency range. You can do the mental arithmetic if you like. But if you take a typical 50 hertz mains cable, I'm just looking for one lying around that won't cause a problem if I pull it about a bit, but you know, this sort of thing. If you look at the conductors here, typically you've got conductor diameter of a millimeter or a little bit more, maybe something like that. If you look at the, you know, put a 50 hertz current into that and look at the current density across the cross section, you will see that actually, if you calculate it, there is a noticeable dip. The current is quite a significantly higher at the surface of the conductor than it is in the center, even at 50 hertz. You know, so the skin depth is quite real. You know, kicks in quite low frequencies. So it's worth thinking about that, but that's our principle, what our principle means by which we reduce the amount of energy penetration through a good conductor. So here's a graph of skin depth, different things. So we're going up in frequency from 10 hertz here to a gigahertz here in steps of 10, 10 hertz, 100 hertz, kilohertz, 10 kilohertz, there's a megahertz, 10 megahertz, 100 megahertz, and so on. And we're looking at the skin depth here in meters. So if we go up to a megahertz there, and we're going to copper, then we're looking at something around a tenth of a millimeter, 100 micrometers at 1 megahertz in copper. Copper's a very, very good conductor. Steel is a poorer conductor at higher frequencies, so it's got a bigger skin depth. This is carbon reinforced plastic, sort of thing you make an aeroplane out of these days. Carbon, you know, this is what you call it, the carbon strands, carbon fibers that you make a composite material from. Again, it's a conductor, but you notice that the we are working on a logarithmic scale again. The skin depth is larger for a given frequency, and that means energy will penetrate through it more easily. The energy is not attenuated quite so much. Steel, you'll notice, has a lower skin depth than copper, and then comes to be higher. This is because steel is a sort of rather complex magnetic material, and its permeability changes over frequency. If you go back to the equation, you'll notice that permeability counts as well. So it's a relative permeability of steel that's giving it its good performance at low frequencies. As that falls off at higher frequencies, and it's just left down to the conductivity, then copper, which is a better conductor, takes over in the megahertz frequency range. We are talking about quite small things here, you know, fractions of a millimeter. So if we're making a box which has structural implications, as well as the box in which we put something, it's likely to be at least a millimeter thick. Then we've got a very large number of skin depths in the thickness of the box. We get a lot of attenuation. Now, there is a very famous model for shielding of enclosure of materials, which is a Shelkov model, and it gives us an insight into how well conductors do shield. I wish I could, but I can't ignore the Shelkov model. It's the one that's in all the good textbooks. It is totally and utterly useless to us. But you have to talk about it. And I'll tell you why it's useless. It's useless because it relies on us having an infinite shield, an infinite plane shield. And we never get an infinite plane shield. We always have an enclosure. And what happens around the enclosure kind of nullifies a lot of what the Shelkov model tells us. But it's perhaps interesting just to see where it comes from. It does give us an indication of what has happened. But it's not much use for sort of actually calculating, I think. And so the Shelkov model said, well, we've got an incident wave coming onto our shield here. The shield is a good conductor. That means in terms of the wave, we've got an intrinsic wave impedance here of 377 ohms, the ratio of electric to magnetic field in the wave. It goes into the conducting material, which has a completely different intrinsic impedance, different ratio of electric to magnetic field, and so there is a refraction boundary. Across any impedance boundary, there's a refraction. We've then got a wave propagating into the material, and it's being attenuated. So this is the skin depth kicking in, this is the attenuation due to the skin depth. We've then got a second reflection at that second boundary there, and something is transmitted through. That's what goes through. That's the, if you like, gives us the shielding effectiveness of the material. Reflection, attenuation, second reflection. If we haven't got very much attenuation, then we might have to account for multiple refractions. Generally speaking, in most materials, the attenuation is such that we only have to worry about the reflection of each side. And so if we're talking in terms of sort of decibels, we can just add all these things together. They're multiplicative, so in decibel terms, we can add them all together. And that Shelbkoff model tells us what kind of shielding effectiveness we're going to get from materials. Now, this diagram here is for a 0.1 millimeter thick aluminium sheet. Conductivity of 3.5 times 10 to the 7 Siemens per meter. And it's got a relative permeability of 1. In other words, it's not magnetic. So this is the, if you like, a sort of good baseline. And again, we're going from 10 hertz to a gigahertz. Now, don't worry about the diagram on the left there. That's rather too complicated to explain. But if we just look at this line here, it's called plane wave. That's a standard electromagnetic wave hitting the shield. And we've got something under, about 130 dBs of attenuation. And then it suddenly takes off as we go up in frequency, up to where this is where the skin effect really starts to kick in. So 130 dBs and then increasing. Now 130 dBs is an enormous number, or an enormous ratio. In power terms, that's 10 to the 13. So, you know, it's almost impossible to, it's very, very difficult to get anything that's got 130 dBs of anything, basically. And as for 450 dBs, well, what could that possibly be? I mean, I'm guessing, you know, even if we're looking at sort of path losses in deep space probes, you know, they're not that kind of level. We're trying to work out what they are, really, but, you know, I have great difficulty with any decibel number that is in three figures, frankly. Difficult to measure. I tend not to believe it. So this tenth of a millimetre, you know, it's cooking foil, is giving us an enormous amount of shielding. So that gives you the clue, really, that any problem with shielding is not down to the material, generally speaking. It's down to what you do with it and how you make use of it. That's the real message. So, let's start at very low frequencies and work our way up. And again, sort of classical thing here when we're talking about electromagnetic structures and so on. The question to ask all the time when you're thinking about something is how big is it in wavelengths? Right? Never mind how big is it physically, how big is it in wavelengths? I mean, I tell our undergraduates, at least I used to be, I was allowed to lecture to, I'm no longer allowed to lecture to undergraduates in York, because I've been paid off, so they won't let me teach the undergraduates anymore. But anyway, what I was allowed to teach them, used to say to them, the UK has a national grid, the 50 hertz power grid, and it stretches from the north of Scotland right down to the southwest of England, and it's 1,500 kilometres long, maximum extent. I guess Turkey probably has a bigger one. Okay? And then I tell them, electromagnetically, that power grid is smaller than that. Because what counts as the wavelength? Now, my phone here, working at a variety of frequencies, but let's take the sort of the Wi-Fi typical frequency, 2.5 gigahertz or thereabouts. Wavelength of 2.5 gigahertz is about 120 millimeters, something like that, 125 millimeters. That's about a wavelength, something like that. Okay. the UK power grid works at 50 hertz, where the electromagnetic wave 50 hertz is 6,000 kilometers. So the UK's power grid is only a quarter of a wavelength in maximum extent. So it's quite small. Well, that quarter wavelength is actually quite important, because when you're controlling the grid, you're turning power stations on, you're turning them off as demand varies across the whole grid, then the equations that are used, if you like, in the software and the control strategy are based on electromagnetic wave propagation on transmission lines, not on circuit theory. It has to be, because it's still a quarter of a wavelength, so you have to think in terms of wavelengths. It's significant compared to the wavelengths. And what we're talking about here is how big is our shield compared to the wavelength. And the first low-frequency shielding I want to talk about, cadence theory, is based around shields that are tiny compared to the wavelength. So we might be talking about a shield that is the size of a PC enclosure, this kind of size, at a frequency of 1 megahertz, where the wavelength is 300 meters. So the shield is much less than 1% of the wavelength. So it's what we call quasi-static. We don't have to think about phase shift across the structure. We can think of the fields having the same electrical phase everywhere on the structure. And so, assume no phase shift, quasi-static, it's not big enough to be resonant, and we're going to start out by assuming there are no apertures. Now, under those circumstances, we can think of a shield as a complete structure. And there are equations, analytical equations, that enable you to work out the shielding effectiveness of a spherical shield of that kind of size at these frequencies. Now, has anybody ever seen a spherical shield? No. Cuboid, yes, spherical, no. It turns out that if you work out the shielding effectiveness of a spherical shield of the same volume as your cuboid shield, the answer is within about 2 or 3 dBs the same at these low frequencies. So spherical shields are actually quite useful from a calculation point of view. If you want to find out how much shielding you've got, just work it out for a spherical shield using the analogy formula from the Cadence theory. When I first came across this, actually, a long, long time ago, when there was a British naval engineer in the UK's Navy. He was a naval officer talking about this. And his name was Captain Field. His actual name was Field, and he was Captain Field, so I thought, what a good thing to talk about if you're Captain Field. There you go. And here we say, this is the wavelength scale effect. How big is the enclosure in wavelengths? DC audio and so on, quasi-static, assuming it was small. Get up to hundreds of megahertz, then the wavelength is, this sort of size. It's the same size as the shield. We get into resonances, and then much higher frequencies, tiny wavelengths. The shield is much bigger than the wavelength. Now we've got multiple resonances, waves bouncing around all over the place, and a completely different approach to how the range thing works. But low frequencies, cadence theory, and we'll assume no apertures. Analytic solutions exist, and spherical results can be used for the different shapes of volumes if they've got the same total volume. So this is where electromagnetic field shieldings differ. Let's have a little electric field shielding to start with. We've got our external electric field. We've got the box. We can think of the sort of top and the bottom of the box as having some charges induced on them. The walls of the box will short out the field anyway, because they're good conductors. So there's going to be no field actually at the box wall. What happens when we start reversing this field, taking it up and down, is of course that these induced charges have to move about. And then we start getting current flow on the surface of the box. And the box walls are now still quite thin compared to the skin depth. We're assuming we're at quite low frequencies where the skin depth is quite large. And so there are significant current flow throughout the box wall cross-section. And of course, the walls being made from real conductors as opposed to perfect conductors have some resistance. And so as this current flow is taking place, there will be a potential difference between the top and the bottom of the box. That potential difference gives rise to an internal electric field, and the shielding is not perfect. There is an internal field. And as the current frequency of the field is increased, the actual current flow has to increase, because you've got to move the same amount of charge in a shorter time. That means that the voltage across the box here increases and the internal field increases. So the shielding effectiveness reduces as we increase the frequency in these low frequency machines. So electric field shielding starts out incredibly good and reduces as we increase the frequency. And you can see that happening here in these graphs. Again, we've got enormous shielding effectiveness. This is for a 100 millimeter diameter shell, so this is something the size of an orange, if you like, which could be a small piece of electronic equipment if it was cuboid. Again, one millimeter wall thing, so we've made it out of a sheet of aluminium or something. And you can see that for copper here, 300 dBs at 10 Hz, decreasing as we go up in frequency. 300 dBs, you'll never measure that in a million years. But that's what it gives us. And then as the skin effect starts to kick in, as we go up to radio frequencies, the shield performance increases again. It's decreasing because of this increased, or because of the resistance of the surface, but it kicks in and you start to get an increase again, rocketing off above 300 dBs. Carbon fibre reinforced plastic, again, rather lower, decreases and then starts to get better as we get to frequencies where the skin depth starts to take over. But you can see a generally diminishing number, but enormous values of shielding effectiveness, hundreds of decibels. So even here, what we're going to be seeing in the real enclosure is issues with the way it's manufactured, not about the materials from which it's made. If we think in terms of magnetic fields now, because we can separate electric and magnetic fields at these very low frequencies. Here's our box again. I've now got a magnetic field oscillating here. This box has no magnetic properties, it's just made out of aluminium, we'll say. And so what's happening there is that at DC, if you have a static magnetic field, then the internal field strength will be exactly the same as the external field strength. The magnetic field is not affected by the aluminium box. What happens, of course, is that as we change the magnetic field strength, we induce eddy currents around the circumference of the box there, and those eddy currents produce our own magnetic field that tends to oppose the magnetic field generated. Is that Lenz's law, I think, or something like that? One of those. And so we get a reduction in total internal field in the box as a consequence of that. And that tells us that as we increase the frequency, the magnetic field shielding effectiveness will start to increase because of that increased eddy current around the periphery of the box there. What we have to be careful of now, though, is things like gaps and lids and so on that will increase the resistance, reduce the eddy currents, and thereby reduce the shielding effectiveness. And if we think about that box as, for instance, having a lid here, top surface of the box is having a lid, bearing in mind the effect is coming predominantly from the walls, then the fact that lid might not fit very well probably doesn't make very much difference for the magnetic field shielding. If we were to put the lid on this face here, and you know we've got a bit of a gap here or not very well fitting with an increased resistance, and those eddy currents are going to be reduced by the poor conductivity across that gap, then the shielding effectiveness will be reduced. So the shielding effectiveness of a box depends on the orientation of the box. If we've got mechanical structural issues, and it's not a complete shell, which you can't, because how would you put anything inside it if there were no lids or apertures? So again, it's not simple. We have to think about how these things work. And here's our magnetic field shielding effectiveness. Again, going from 0 dBs at very low frequencies and then increasing. And then goes up in that sense, until we go to a frequency where the skin effect kicks in and then starts to increase even more so. So we go from nothing and increase again, 150 dBs at the top. So electric field shielding, very good at low frequencies. Magnetic field shielding, very poor at low frequencies. If we want to do anything about magnetic fields, then we have to use ferromagnetic materials, where the permeability comes in. And then we're into a different ball game altogether. Here's a sort of bit of a diagram I pinched from somewhere or other. There's a shell made from a ferromagnetic material. It could be steel, it could be new metal, whatever. And it just sort of shows the magnetic flux lines coming out of a bar magnet. And you can see the flux lines are concentrated in the shell, not going through the middle there. And this is effectively a magnetic circuit. You've done anything about magnetic circuits in your studies about magnetic field. But the magnetic flux is excluded from the interior of the shell because of the high permeability here and here compared to the permeability of free space in the middle. So magnetic field, low frequency shielding, you need magnetic materials. That was a problem. I mean, when I was, just after I left university, when I finished my PhD, I worked for British Air, what was then the British Aircraft Corporation. We were involved with a spacecraft called GEOS at the time, which was 40 years ago, which was looking at the Earth's magnetic fields, sort of sensing them. And it had a spacecraft bus, and then it had magnetic field sensors out on booms to measure the Earth's magnetic field as it orbited the Earth. And the big problem we had, was that the electronic circuits in the spacecraft generated magnetic fields, as they will, because currents flow in them. And we needed to shield the magnetic field sensors from the magnetic fields generated inside the spacecraft. And the easy way to do that, it was quite low frequency, between the audio frequencies and sub-audio, a few hertz. The obvious way to do that would be to put a magnetic material shell around, new metal or whatever. The rocket would have stayed on the launching pad if we'd done that, because the weight would have been too low. And the way in which we did it in the end was very clever. For every circuit card, circuits on, we had a peripheral trace around the circuit card, an extra circuitry to generate current in the peripheral trace that generated an equal and opposite magnetic field to the operational currents on the circuit card. And that expensive way of doing it was the only way we could reduce magnetic fields to the level that the spacecraft could operate. We couldn't afford to put a magnetic shield on because it would be too heavy. Because these materials are really rather heavy. Think of steel or new metal and so on. They're quite heavy things. So where you see ferromagnetic shielding applications, things like electron microscopes, biomedical measurements, then MRI scans and so on. There you want to have some magnetic field shielding and big magnets. That's where you're using ferromagnetic shielding materials. I say oscilloscopes because oscilloscopes these days are all flat screen displays. They used to have cathode ray tubes in them with magnetic deflection. Then you had new metal around the cathode ray tubes. So we'll take the top one off there, really. But we don't see that kind of oscilloscope anymore. But you can see there's one there, you see, a cathode ray tube. That's an old picture. So that would have to be shielded from what's inside there. So there we are. Types of shielding materials, sheet metal, excellent, plastic with a conductive coating, yeah, that's good, that's metal again, conductive polymers, not so good, grids and meshes, that's putting materials inside otherwise non-conductive composites, they work, you can usually perhaps get light through them or whatever, not so good, and then composite materials themselves, carbon fibre, higher resistance, lower performance. So there's the sort of summary for low frequency. Electric field can use very thin coatings or poor conductors as well. Magnetic fields, you're relying on eddy currents, and so not working very well at low frequencies. But if you want to improve your low frequency shielding, thicker walls, higher conductivity, higher permeability, and smaller enclosures. Those are the things that work for these low frequencies. Okay, so let's go up to at higher frequencies now. I'm waiting for time. A few minutes to run. Higher frequencies, if we just apply the Sholkhanov theory, we'll get more dBs than we can possibly cope with. You know, hundreds, thousands of dBs, whatever that means. Meaningless numbers. And the real level of shielding that we get is determined by the size of the enclosure and its structure. And the principal things are, from a size point of view, does it resonate? And from a structural point of view, what about the apertures and the cables? Those are the things that limit what's going on, what we're going to get. So let's have a look at some of those effects. Let's think about enclosure resonances. Now, there's, again, we always start with the empty enclosure, although we never use an empty enclosure. And we could always start with a cuboid enclosure, because most enclosures are cuboidal. I mean, if you look at a PC enclosure or whatever, it's a cube. We live in a Cartesian world. We live in X, Y, and Z, basically. We don't live in R, theta, phi, and still we start sort of going into orbit. On the ground, we're X, Y, Z. If you think of a cuboid, dimensions X, Y, Z, then there's a famous Helmholtz equation. It tells you the resonant frequency of these enclosures. And you can see it's in terms of X and Y and Z, and in terms of three integers, M, N, and P, one of which can be zero. So if you have a sort of a 1, 1, 0 resonance, or a 1, 0, 1 resonance, or a 0, 1, 1 resonance of the enclosure. And typically, if we look at an enclosure here, a 30 by 30 by 12 centimeter enclosure, then the lowest resonant frequency, which is the 110, is 700 megahertz. Not particularly high frequency, but often sort of getting towards microwave frequency range. But 700 megahertz. You make a bigger box, the resonant frequency will go down. Typical screened room where that's an MRI scanner, for instance, you might have a resonant frequency of say 50 or 60 megahertz at the lowest frequency. And the thing that happens is that as we go up in frequency, more and more resonances kick in. So the lowest resonant frequency, 110, we can go to the 111, 120, and so on. We just keep increasing M, N, and P, and the resonant frequencies go up. But the other thing is that as we increase the frequency, the rate at which the resonances kick in increases. So we have to go quite a few megahertz, a few tens of megahertz before we get the next resonance. Carry on up, and the third resonance is a bit closer. And by the time we've got to maybe the 10th or the 20th resonance, they're coming thick and fast. Resonance is all over the place. Now, what we tend to find is that we get relatively poor shielding effectiveness of the resonant frequencies, because the resonances enhance the internal fields. They build up the whole point of the resonant. I mean, it's a very good analogy here with using instruments. You know, you can think of something like a violin, for instance. The body of the violin is a resonant enclosure. You know, you're exciting the resonances in the strings, but also in the body of the violin as well. Wind instruments, again, resonant effects. The whole point of resonance is it does enhance things. So we can get rather poor SEs at the resonant frequencies, rather poor shielding at resonant frequencies. But I'll look at that a bit later on. Let's think about apertures. Well, apertures behave rather like spot antennas. The dipole antenna that you might be familiar with as a simple radiating structure has a thing called a dual, sort of something equivalent to it with a different structure. And if you imagine you have a sheet of material, rather long wire, imagine a long spot in a sheet of material, that will radiate as well. Radiators in the orthogonal sense, but it will radiate. And so if we've got an aperture like that in our shield, well, the shield might work very well. If that aperture is longer than about a tenth of the wavelength, then it will start to allow electromagnetic energy to penetrate through it. And then you've got an enclosure potentially with resonances inside. you'll find your shielding performance is destroyed. In fact, the internal field might in fact be higher than the external field at the resonant frequency. So we have to be very careful in making slot antennas, and particularly when the slot gets to about a halfway length long, it's a very efficient means of getting energy into the box. A very efficient antenna. The shielding will be completely destroyed. We'll come back to that a bit later on. One of the reasons for having apertures like this in an enclosure, of course, is that we have to get air in there for ventilation. We might need cooling fans. If your laptop is got a shielded enclosure, it's got a cooling fan. You don't have long slots for cooling fans. What you do is you have many small apertures. And you might have a number of small apertures. If you've got those three small apertures there, their total area is probably bigger than the area of that slot. So you get more air through. But they will have a much smaller effect on allowing waves through, because in wavelength terms they're rather smaller. The aperture is small compared to the wavelength, it doesn't allow energy to penetrate very well. And you only need one dimension of the aperture to be wavelength and scale, to be a tenth of a wavelength or bigger, for it to become a very good transmitter of energy. So if you think in terms of this long slot here as being maybe half a wavelength, you know, a few centimetres at a few hundred megahertz, and it can be fraction of a millimetre in the other dimension, just a small gap in where the lid fits, and you've got an aperture antenna that's very efficient, and the energy will get into the enclosure. So it's the way in which the enclosure is made that determines it, how well made it is that determines how good the shielding is. So if you look at a PC enclosure, where the fan is, you see it's an array of small holes rather than one big hole. That's the shielding. Small holes are much better. An array of small holes is much better at blocking energy than a larger hole with the same surface area, which will let energy in much more efficiently. That's why you do it. Now, there's a simple aperture model here that I think you're getting this presentation. If you're interested in this, then there's a website there that you've got, it's got an incredibly long name. But here we've got an enclosure, and it's got a single aperture in it, and you can change the size of the enclosure, you can change the size of the aperture, and you can just use a simple calculator we've developed that will tell you what the shielding effectiveness of the enclosure is as an empty enclosure. And you can play with this and just sort of experiment with what I'm talking about. It's assumed that the enclosure is otherwise perfect, it's just got one aperture. You can see that this is what the that nice smooth curve is what the calculator tells you. The rather rougher curves allow measurements that confirm that the calculator is telling us a sensible answer, in other words, within a few dBs is the correct answer. One measured it's a couple of different antenna types, and one measured inside a magnetic strip line. But you can see they're all doing more or less the same thing. But the thing to note is that the resonant frequency is 700 megahertz. Well, I've done the calculation for the sizes that I mentioned in the previous slide. The shielding effectiveness is actually worse than zero. So in fact, it's minus 20 dBs. That says that you've got a field enhancement. The field inside the enclosure is 10 times bigger than the field outside the enclosure because of the resonance at this first resonant frequency. So if you're interested, have a play with that. You'll see the effect of what the aperture will do for you. I think it looks rather different to that now. We've changed our website, but the address is correct at the bottom. So just sort of looking at what we've got then, here's the back of a PC from our lab, just a photograph of it. You see sort of a quick photograph, you see cables hanging there and one or two notices, but this is what we're actually looking at. And so we've got multiple holes here for ventilation. Seams here will act as aperture antennas, so if you've got a... There's a seam, look. It's quite a few centimetres long. If somebody paints those, or puts a non-conducting coating on there, that's turning that seam into a slot antenna, because you've got a gap. You haven't got connectivity all around the seam. You've got some cable penetrations around here, all of which are apertures, which will allow energy to get in. It depends on how well they're terminated. And then you've got some very obvious slots there where the whole thing fits together. and is not very well put together. A PC enclosure like that, depending on the frequency, will give you between 40 dBs of shielding effectiveness, field reduction of about 100, down to more or less nothing. That's the kind of shielding effectiveness you get from something like that, unless you actually buy a good one, unless you bother with it. But a simple one like that, 20, 40 dBs is all you're going to get, a factor of 100 or factor of 10 reduction in internal field. So there are things we can do with our apertures, slots. We can put conducting gaskets across places where we have connections. We can do a thing called finger strip, show you that in a minute. Overlap the joint, put lots of screws in. If we want an aperture to be less than a tenth of a wavelength long, then we have to put a screw to connect it every 3 centimetres at a gigahertz. The open frequency, you have to put screws in closer together. Try and keep the length of the aperture, the slot, where we put two things together small. It's how long is the longest dimension of it? And then a thing called below cutoff waveguides. Keep the aperture small, less than 10 of a wavelength. Put a contact at seams, and then cables, filters, and screen cables. Don't just connect the screen of the cable to the enclosure. A 360 degree screen connection all the way around, a pop connection. Again, otherwise you're just compromising your screen. Some enclosures come very, very small indeed. We're just trying to get started now with a new measurement of screening effectiveness of board level enclosures. If you look inside your mobile phone, you'll find there are two or three screen enclosures in there that are maybe 1 or 2 centimetres in dimensions. Nobody's ever come up with a standard for measuring how good those things are. How do you know what you're getting from it? You don't. We're trying to address that. But here's a board level enclosure. So this on the screen there is what you've seen. It's about that big, maybe 5 centimetres. And you can see it's clipped together, there are no screws in that, but look at where it's clipped together here. What you've got there, those this is called fingers. These aren't fingers. They're, and when you clip it together, they actually slide across the surface. And so if there's any impurity, any oxidation or anything like that, that sliding contact wipes it and gives you, hopefully, a better metallic contact. And you will maintain your shielding. So, you know, surfaces and metals very quickly become contaminated, particularly aluminium, get an oxide layer. The wiping contact will break through that and give you a good metallic contact. That's what you're aiming for. This is a picture of inside our reverberation chamber. We use reverberation chambers for a lot of our measurements. And we've actually got one chamber inside another chamber. If you're familiar with reverberation chambers, you'll know what I'm talking about. If you're not, just hang on for a minute or two. But what we do is we're trying to measure the performance of shielding materials by looking at the penetration of energy from one reverberation chamber into another one, a nested chamber inside the first one. And so we have a round, you can just see there's a round structure there, which sandwiches the material that we're measuring, which is this material here. A thin sandwich there, that's got a metal plating. So our sample goes in this round hole and it's sandwiched down, clamped down, sort of get good contact at the edge. And then we're looking at what goes through that hole from outside into this metallic chamber. And that's an incredibly difficult measurement to do. And you can see that the length we've gone to, these are 4 millimeter bolts. So we've got them every two centimetres, effectively. That torque down to a known torque figure. And we've got thousands of dollars, Turkish pounds, UK pounds worth of metal trying to sort of isolate these two chambers one from another. So the only thing we measure is what goes through that hole at the top. And the best measurement we've ever managed to make in that environment is a shielding effectiveness of 70 decibels. Because you just can't get the performance out of the materials, out of the structure. incredibly difficult to get good shear measurements. This is a way of microwave frequencies. And it's all the little sort of imperfections that are limiting this. So trying to measure what the material is doing, very, very difficult. And it's all down to mechanical imperfections of what we're dealing with. This is our large screen room, which the reverberation chamber is in. You can see we've got the door open here, it's a rather peculiar photograph. The door closes, and you can see there's finger stop on the door there, sort of wiping spring contacts. So every time the door closes, you've got these sort of contacts, and the door comes in, and they wipe and depress these contacts. And there's a wiping pressure action every time the door closes. It effectively, hopefully, removes any dirt or oxide from the surface and gets a good contact again. So the contact is remade every time we open and close the door to try and maintain shielding effectiveness. Once we're in a room like that, then we've got many resonant modes. We're talking about statistics, Q factors, and all sorts of things. If you're interested in that, come along on Friday, because that's what I'm talking about on Friday. But I'm still looking at a sort of large enclosure. Here's another picture of the joint of our enclosure. I mentioned using gaskets where you've got joints. Part of the wall, metallic strip. That metallic strip is actually about that wide, about 3 centimetres wide. So every 6 centimetres there's a bolt, tightening it down to try and get a good contact. And we're actually compressing, you can see the metal mesh gasket in there. We're compressing a gasket to try and get a good contact, a good conducting contact, to make the shielding work. That's the whole chamber. Like that, you can see it's quite a big chamber. There's a door you can walk through. So it's about 4.5 meters by 3 meters by 2.5 meters. It's quite a big chamber, made out of sections, put together like that. When you're talking those up to get performance, you put the chamber together. You tighten all the screws up to a particular torque, in a particular order. Then you go around again for the second time, and you tighten them up to a higher torque, in a different order. And then you go around a third time and tighten them up to maximum torque in yet a different order. And that's the only way they can get it all tightened together to get the performance from. It takes days. Technical staff are going bonkers like this. Trying to get everything in the right order. Get the chamber to work. Last thing I want to talk about. Having put that all together, you then need ventilation. And there's a typical ventilation panel. A bit difficult to see, but what you've got is an array of square apertures all put together. But those square apertures have depth. In fact, they're waveguides. And if you think about, here's a sort of single aperture. Now, as a tube going into the enclosure, you've done your waveguide theory, you know waveguides have a cutoff frequency at which the electromagnetic energy, below which the electromagnetic energy can't get through. And typically, in round numbers, that diameter there, when it gets to a half wavelength, then the energy can go through. So any frequency above where that is a half wavelength, the energy can go through. But if frequency is below where that is a half wavelength, then you get attenuation. And you get attenuation in decibels of 32 times the length of the diameter ratio. So if you make the length of the tube four times its diameter, you've got 128 decibels of attenuation, and that is as good as you'll get from the chamber itself anyway. So your ventilation is done with an array of these things. They were square in the picture, they can be square or circular. Typically they're square. Same, I think it's 28 dBs. It's square, but it's more or less the same. And if I just go back there, you imagine what you've got then is an array of rectangular tubes with a depth going into the room where the depth is about four times the cross-section dimension of the tube. And that will give you about 120, 130 dBs of attenuation with good airflow through there. And you need that airflow, not because you have people inside the room, but because when you close the door with the seal, it would try and compress the air. You'd never get the door closed if you didn't have something like that to relieve the air pressure inside the room. So that's a way of looking at that. They're 1 centimetre cross-section. So that says that if that's a half wavelength, the wavelength is 2 centimeters, that's 15 gigahertz. So any frequency below 15 gigahertz, that acts as a barrier. You go up above 15 gigahertz, and you've got a 30 centimeter square hole in the roof of your chamber, because it can just go straight through. There's no shielding at all. So it's quite a stark thing. It's an absolute cliff edge. Very, very spectacular, the measuring frequencies. So there we are then. Just some conclusions. I think it's an interesting mix of electrical and mechanical problems. And we have to deal with things that come from rooms down to centimeter sized things on circuit cards. We haven't quite gone to shielding enclosures on silicon yet. It'll come. We're doing signal integrity crosstalk mitigation on shielding on circuit. I'm not aware of anybody putting an enclosure on silicon yet. And the main thing that says, in understanding it, is how big is the thing in wavelength? That's what determines what goes on. And the main limiting factor, usually, this is always, but usually, is how you make it, not what you make it from. So there you are, there's a very quick look around shielding from sort of DC to daylight, and from sort of big rooms down to circuit cards. And I've only overrun by 3 minutes. That's not so bad, is it? I've never done it before, so there you are. Which is a new one. So thank you very much for listening. If you've got any questions, I'd be happy to answer them or whatever. Thank you.